I do believe that it is time to cut the Gordian knot. But to cut the Gordian knot by finding a compromise solution, a solution that would satisfy at least some of the wishes of both the Serbs and Albanians in Kosovo and Metohija. And for this purpose, we should do at least a couple of things. One of the things that we need to do is to refrain ourselves from all sorts of unilateral actions. As we speak here today in this hall, the parliament in Pristina is having a vote on the transformation of the so-called Kosovo Security Force into the so-called quote-unquote army of the quote-unquote Republic of Kosovo. After so many years of war, after so many years of conflict, without a political solution, even maybe on the horizon, someone is yet again making a unilateral step, trying to change the reality on the ground by doing an action that leads us to further militarization. This type of activity can lead us only into further escalations. This means that unilateral actions need to stop. I remember clearly when in 2012 we initiated the high-level dialogue, one of the first understandings that we had with our Kosovo-Albanian colleagues was to try and settle the disputes around the negotiating table, not to do it under the table, behind the scenes, or without each other. What is happening now is not in the spirit or in line of what we envisaged 6 years ago. However, I must also say that I do not agree that actually, there is one important thing that I agree with, I first want to say, with what Ilir said. No one here wants division along ethnic lines. Serbia is today a multi-ethnic society. But to be quite honest with each other, what happened in 2008 was exactly division on ethnic basis and along ethnic lines. Because when unilateral declaration of independence was done in 2008, it was done based on aspirations of majority Albanian people in Kosovo and Metohija. And in a territory in which, unfortunately, after the wars and all of the ethnic cleansing, more than 90% of the population were ethnic Albanians. In that sense, I want to say that any kind of solution, if we achieve it, will definitely not mean that Belgrade and Pristina will remain without Serbs or Albanians respectively. And no such solution is something that we are aiming for. We are aiming for a solution that would create a new paradigm in relation between Serbs and Albanians. It is often underestimated how much of our politics here in the Balkans is about psychology and emotions. And I'm trying to speak these days a bit more about it. We need to put each other into one another's shoes more often and to try to understand each other. If we reach an agreement on two core issues that are unresolved, this is the question of status and the question of territory. And if we Serbs and Albanians manage to shake hands on these two issues, I do believe that the overall relation between not just Belgrade and Pristina, but Serb and Albanian people in the Balkans would change for better. And it would set another important precedent in our region. And that is that important disputes are being settled not through conflict, but through peaceful means, through dialogue, and through agreement between the parties. And we will continue working in this direction, no matter what the difficulties might be ahead. For Serbia, achieving lasting peace and stability is crucial. We've got everything else more or less figured out about our future. We know what we want now as a nation after 30 years of terrible trauma. And never please underestimate those of you who maybe don't have the opportunity to follow the situation here on a daily basis. Please never underestimate the trauma that all of us together went through as a region in the past 3 decades. So some things certainly definitely need time. We had here at the forum the opportunity to listen to the representatives of Austria, representatives of other countries who've had historic experiences of their own with ethnic issues, and definitely to heal some wounds, it will take time, determination, and effort. And it will always be unpopular, always be unpopular. If you know the Serbs and Albanians well, we are very passionate about politics, we are very passionate about history, we are very proud, we are very passionate when it comes to friendships. This means that we are good friends, but we are also terrible adversaries when we fight. And in that sense, if we manage to shake hands on a deal that would leave both parties equally satisfied, or leaving with something achievable and presentable to our nations, I believe that the doors of the future, in a sense, would open. But unfortunately, I don't want to spread, you know, optimism which is not based on what's happening on the ground, on the reality. There are still too many centripetal forces, so to say. There are still too many factors that are bringing us further away from a solution than there are circumstances that are bringing us closer together. But
what will be different? What will be different from today? You reach an agreement, you sign it, it's approved, everybody likes it. What will be different on the daily basis? What will be the difference?
I don't even dare to entirely dream about everything that we can achieve, because the realities of today are still too dire. But if you ask Ilir, or if you ask any of our other colleagues from any part of this region, one of the first things you will hear is how frustrated we get when we have to, you know, stop at these checkpoints every 40, 50, or 100 kilometers. And it has nothing to do with our national pride, our national dignity, our, you know, national interest. It has all to do about, it has everything to do with politics and lack of understanding. Our side, President Vučić has proposed already 2 years ago a very bold initiative to ease the circulation of people, goods, and everything in our region. So far, some have supported this, but still political obstacles prevail in realization of this type of ideas. And though there are people who are working to create a better climate for relations, there are still many more who like to exploit the unresolved conflict for purposes of their own. Some of them are exploiting it for domestic political purposes, and of course there are many those beyond our region who are, you know, seeing our region as an opportunity to show off their political strength or political interests. And we need to be aware of this. Serbs and Albanians, we don't need to be anybody's chessboard, no matter where they come from. I think that we all need to be very realistic about the situation. And I think that we, while looking for a solution, must keep looking at ourselves in the mirror. And when I say this, I mean that we need to realistically assess our situation. I've heard here, you know, the argument of my esteemed colleague. One of the things he said, if I understood correctly, is that the so-called independence of Kosovo is a given, that it is irreversible. I don't believe that this is the case. You know, I do believe that the situation is such that Kosovo is not independent. It is not a member of the United Nations. It is not a member of OSCE. It is not a member of all major international organizations. It is not independent when it comes to providing security on its territory, because it has huge international presence in terms of security missions from both NATO and the European Union. Financially, economically, it is very much dependent on funding from international community and from also exchange with other countries as well. We can now enter into almost philosophical debate whether there are and to what extent are generally territories and countries in today's modern world independent and sovereign. But certainly membership in international organizations and full security territory of security control of a territory qualifies as part of the core definition of a state. And I'm not sure that in this case this definition has been fulfilled by any means. No one will bring to Pristina on a silver plate what they expect to achieve or receive when it comes to materializing their dreams about membership in international organizations or reaffirming their position in the international community without a compromise with Belgrade. Equally, no one will with the magic wand fulfill, you know, our vision of how the resolution 1244 should have been implemented or how our constitution should be implemented on the entire territory of our state. It is clear that we require a compromise, and what has been done in 2008, I do not believe that it was a solution. It happened not during the era of the Milosevic regime. It did not happen during the conflict time. It happened 8 years after the end of the war. We don't expect any presents for ourselves. We expect a fair deal, a deal in which both sides will achieve something for their people and for their long-term interests.